Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Let me start with a big picture here. And in particular, with this, I really like this quote by this English mathematician and philosopher saying that civilization advances by extending the number of important operations that we can do without thinking about them, so that we can do automatically. So this follows up very naturally on James's talk from yesterday, where he showed that simple automated methods such as random search and more complicated automated methods such as sequential model-based optimization can do much better than manual search, and it can also lead to more and more scientific methods and, saving a lot of human time. So my research agenda is very much along those lines. It's to use machine learning and to use optimization to help algorithm designers automate parts of algorithm design. All the tedious stuff, automated tuning, fiddling with your parameters, figuring out which parameters are important, etc. You can use automated methods for that, and that's what my research is on. And this particular talk is on improving methods from Bayesian optimization to actually scale up to real-world applications. Right. So here's a quick overview of the talk. I'll first introduce Bayesian optimization very much along the lines that James talked about yesterday, and then talk about extensions to the problem of algorithm configuration, which is to set the parameters of an algorithm in order to optimize its performance, empirical performance. Then talk about random embeddings for scaling up Bayesian optimization to very high dimensions, and about an application of SMBO for combined model selection and hyperparameter optimization. All right, let's get started with the introduction. So we saw a similar picture to this yesterday. So we have a black box function. It's this black, this dotted line here is a true objective that we want to, in this case, maximize. And it's a black box function. It's this black box here. We can put an input in, and we get an output out. That's all we're allowed to do. We can query the function at any x and get out the value of x, maybe distorted by some noise. And we don't have gradients. We don't have any closed form representation of it. We can only query it. So they say this dotted line here is our true objective. What we can do, and what we in fact do in sequential model-based optimization, is to fit a model, a response surface of this function. So here we have a mean estimate and uncertainty. And then we can use this model in order to determine what is the most promising query to ask next. So there's various forms of acquisition functions you could use that are using the model in order to determine how promising a point is. For example, here there is expected improvement, which really, in the end of the day, what you want is a point that has high predicted mean when we're maximizing, but also high predictive uncertainty. So you have this inherent trade-off of exploration and exploitation, and these acquisition functions are meant to attack this exploration-exploitation trade-off. So this.
So what's the definition of acquisition function?
It is this. So it's just a function. You have the data, and it's a utility measure over the space. And I mean, that's the abstract definition. In sequential model-based optimization, which is kind of one way of doing Bayesian optimization using this model, you use a model, the model predicts a mean, it predicts a variance, and you use these predicted means and variance as predictive distribution in order to measure how useful a point is. And so here's, let's step back. So in this case here, we optimize this acquisition function, we maximize it, pick this data point to query next. We query it, we update our model, the model changes locally and a little bit globally. We recompute our acquisition function, maximize it, pick this point, and iterate. So that's kind of the vanilla version of sequential Bayesian, sequential model-based optimization. The general Bayesian optimization framework doesn't necessarily depend on the model, but in this talk, I'll really be using Bayesian optimization and sequential model-based optimization as pretty much interchangeable. This SMBO is really a special case of BO that's using a model. And it doesn't necessarily have to be using a prior. It doesn't necessarily have to be Bayesian in that sense. They're kind of intersecting, and maybe one is not a strict subset of the other. So these model-based optimization techniques are known to be very efficient in terms of the number of function evaluations that they require in order to find the global maximum. And they work when the objective can be very wonky. It can be non-convex. You might even not know the derivatives. It might not exist derivatives. There might be discrete change points. There might be all kinds of interesting properties of this function that disallow you, for example, to use the standard optimization techniques. And you can analyze these methods in terms of regret. So the regret at time t is just defined as the deviation from the maximum of the function at your t sample. And recent work in the machine learning mostly machine learning community has shown that this regret can vanish in some cases exponentially quickly in the noiseless case, or in the noisy case, not quite as quickly, but it vanishes over time. And so you actually do converge to the global optimum of this function under certain assumptions, of course, on the function. The same analysis can be done for Bayesian optimization that doesn't actually use a model. So in the exam standard setting, there's similar regret bounds on exponential regret bounds on the noiseless case. So there's these strong theoretical foundations, and also empirical results show that this works well if you have low dimensions, if your function is continuous. There hasn't been a whole lot of work extending this to the discrete case. We heard some of James yesterday, and I'll show you some today. It's not a coincidence that we're both here at the same time, because this is, we're some of the few people working on it. Here's an animation of how the sequential model-based optimization actually works. This blue function and your uncertainty estimates, and one thing that you might see in this is that the red one is what you evaluate at a current point in time, and that jumps around quite wildly, and at some point it kind of homes into a local region, then at some point it might decide to jump and explore more globally again. But so there is this trade-off between exploration and exploitation, and that actually happens in practice. This is a minimization problem, actually. Sorry, it doesn't match with the slide, I know. Sorry. In the rest of the talk, I'll talk about actually minimization problems. And in one case, that will be actually important.
Given your initial setup, right, you just have black box, and that's actually the original problem that genetic algorithms can be solved. How do you compare this technique with the genetic algorithms? How can you
Right. You're very right. Genetic algorithms is one particular tool for solving these black box optimization problems. And in the case where you have a lot of parameters, actually high-dimensional optimization, and relatively cheap function optimizations, genetic algorithms tend to actually perform best. There is a black box function optimization competition, for example, that goes on every other year at Gecko, at the Genetic Algorithms Conference. And it's for the last three iterations has been won by this technique CMAES, which is a covariance matrix adaptation evolutionary strategy. Their setup differs a little bit. They run function evaluation. They have a budget of millions or even billions of function evaluations. Here we're trying to get close to the optimum of the function in few function evaluations. So if every function evaluation takes an hour, your genetic algorithm is not going to do very well. It's very related work. Yeah?
The
I'm not aware of any global optimization, global convergence rates of genetic algorithms. There is certainly a lot of work on it converging locally, and there's work on it in the limit. It's exploring the whole space, but certainly there's no convergence guarantees. And for discrete function optimization, yeah, sure, you can prove that it exhausts the space in the limit because, well, the space is finite. But for the infinite case, I'm not aware of any theory, let's say, like that. Right. Good. So the sequential model-based optimization framework is pretty powerful in the low-dimensional case, and there's all this theory, and I would really like to apply this to these real-world problems that we have. Where, this was kind of in 2009 when I finished my PhD thesis on algorithm configuration. And since then, I've been working on extending model-based optimization to that case. So it was slightly less straightforward than I hoped, but it worked in the end. And yeah, so I'll be talking about that next. This part of the talk will actually be kind of the bulk of the talk. And then these two applications are about recent NIPS papers that we submitted, where there's different students in the lead. I'm part of the teams, but this is really the core of my work, so I'll focus on that, and then talk maybe 10 minutes about each of the other ones. All right, this is joint work with my postdoc advisors, Holger Hoos and Kevin Leyton-Brown, and also my previous PhD advisor, Kevin Murphy. And it's kind of following up on my PhD work with my previous master thesis supervisor, Thomas Stützle, and also Holger Hoos and Kevin Leyton-Brown. It started more in the optimization community, where this is based on a local search approach. Then we actually did publish at Gecko in this genetic algorithms community because they have all these parameters of the algorithms. They really want parameter tuners. And then it's been moving more to this learning setting. So LINE is a relatively new conference, learning and intelligent optimization that combines optimization and learning. I think it's the worst case, but I'll defer that to Nando. Yeah. It's his year after all. But yeah, so it really does converge. All right, so this algorithm configuration problem, as I define it, is you have any runnable algorithm A, so you're given the algorithm, you're given the description of its parameters and the domains that they can take. So you have this configuration space that can be combinatorial. If you have like 50 binary parameters, then this is going to have 2 to the 50 instantiations in there. You have a distribution of our problem instances, and you're given a performance metric that might be speed or solution quality or root mean squared error or log loss or whatever you want to optimize, what the user wants to optimize. And you're searching for a configuration of this algorithm that optimizes the metric on the distribution. So this is in the bandits way, this would be on average across contexts. We want to do the optimization across contexts, and we can't control the context at runtime. We just want to optimize over a whole distribution of contexts. During training time, we can say, use this instance next, use this instance next. The motivation for this is to, we'll have versatile algorithms or algorithm frameworks, very much like the ones that James talked about yesterday for computer vision, that can be customized for different situations. So we have a certain type of instances or a use context, maybe a different computing environment. Different algorithms will perform. You want to configure differently if you run on a big cluster of machines or on an iPhone. You will use different data structures, etc. So this could be, if you have these versatile frameworks, then they can just be configured to output the right algorithm for your new application domain or for your new set of instances. And you want to do that automatically and, well, as quickly as possible. So your budget typically is some sort of time budget. You have 2 days to do this, or you have 2 days on 100 computers or something like that. All right, what are these types of parameters? So there's various types of parameters. And here, note that when I talk about parameters, I think about decisions that the algorithm designer has to make. It's not the parameters that are optimized in your machine learning within the algorithm. It's the hyperparameters in James's nomenclature. Anything that the designer of the algorithm decides upon. So these can be continuous, integer, ordinal parameters. And importantly, these categorical parameters that are finite domain, unordered, such as A, B, or C, or red, blue, green. Use any of five heuristics, there's no order. The parameter space also has structure, very much like what James was talking about yesterday. You have conditional parameters. For example, you have an optimizer A, and if you use that optimizer, well, then that optimizer also has parameters, and you want to set those parameters. So in the end, you have this space of algorithms, and the space can be very large. So for example, for CPLEX software for mixed integer programming, you have 10 to the 47 possible configurations, and we're searching that space, and it's actually possible. And these configurations really differ in their qualitative behavior. That's why I tend to not talk about it in terms of parameter tuning, but as algorithm configuration. What type of methods could you use for algorithm configuration? And yes, we could use genetic algorithms, could use any type of population-based algorithms, could use stochastic local search, anything that deals well with discrete optimization. But that's only one component of the problem. That's a component of searching the space. There's also the other component of how do you actually evaluate a configuration? Evaluating the configuration on a whole distribution of instances, well, you can't actually evaluate it on the distribution. You can only evaluate on a finite sample. Do you evaluate it on one instance? That gives you a very high variance. But that might be enough. It's cheap. Or you can evaluate it in more instances. That'll give you lower variance. Very much like in the bandit setting, you don't have a fixed number of pulls that you do for each arm. You can decide about that. So there's these two dimensions of algorithm configuration that we need to work with in practice. Early work in the AI community goes back to the 90s, but these methods haven't been general and domain independent. And over the last couple of years, there have been a couple of methods that are actually that can deal with these large discrete spaces and are domain independent. And well, my thesis was on ParamLS and the SMAC method. I'm talking about SMAC today, and these are actually the state of the art methods that are out there. All right. So why is this a challenge for Bayesian optimization? Typical Bayesian optimization problems, as I said, they have low dimensionality. You have all continuous inputs. Your budget is the number of function evaluations. You have expensive functions, so maybe you can afford up to 200 function evaluations or so. The noise is typically, well, often there's no noise, or if there is noise, it's handled as being small and Gaussian. In practice, that's not the case in the applications that I face. So we have high dimensionality, we have discrete continuous and conditional parameters. The budget is a total time spent, not the number of function evaluations. We often can run single instances instead of evaluating the whole distribution, so our function evaluations are actually kind of fast, so we have to reason about the time that we take in order to build the model and to optimize this acquisition function and so on. That all costs us time budget, so we have to be pretty quick there and quick and dirty, and well, maybe have to give up some of the theoretical guarantees in order to have faster reasoning. Right. But then in practice, we do face situations where we can actually take tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of samples sometimes. So these are five challenges. Most of them we can actually tackle by just switching the model from a Gaussian process to a random forest. Computationally much more effective. So it can deal with, it can also deal with discrete inputs, high dimensions. it's an automatic feature selector. So I'll talk about that a little bit. For this high noise, what I do is kind of an approximate racing strategy that can be viewed as along the lines of bandits, but without any guarantees, where we increase the number of evaluations that the incumbent gets over time, and we have an invariant that you can't replace the incumbent without having at least as many function evaluations as the incumbent. So you kind of safeguard against your model not being perfect, because the model actually in practice is not perfect. Then we have partially censored data. I'll talk about that a little bit later. And we optimize across different contexts. And we can also deal with that in random forest. Yes? We can handle that. So this remember this Bayesian optimization picture where we chose an input to the function and then observed the function value. That gives us So that gives us a data point x maps to f of x. So that's one data point. One function evaluation gives us one data point. Technically, the data point is an x, then which instance did we use, and then which runtime did we have for that configuration and that instance. So it's a triplet, x, pi, f of x, comma, pi. All those variables during training, during test, we want to average over the context. We're not looking at the test set, for sure not. And cross-validation, if you want to talk about it in the machine learning setting, you can say we have 10 folds. Then the instance, we have 10 different instances. We could run one fold 1, fold 2, fold 3. During training, we can select which one we want to use. But on average, we want to optimize across folds. The incumbent is a single parameter configuration. Multiple folds in the hyperparameter optimization one. So in the optimizing combinatorial solvers, it's multiple instances that you put in. You could think about optimizing across different data sets, but that's not really what I'm doing. So the context would for me be which instance do you actually want to attack. So that you have a distribution of sat instances that come from some distribution, for example, software verification. You get all these instances from people trying to verify certain properties of Windows. And they're different, but you can compute features of these instances. And that's your context. And you want to do well across all these different instances. That's what the algorithm design has to do. It's a different setting. You could be in a setting where you observe the instance, you observe the features, and then you can select a configuration for that instance. That's not the setting that I'm attacking here. The models are the same, the objective is different, so the acquisition function would be different, etc. But in the end of the day, it's very related. All right, let me move on. So I'll talk first about increasing distance over time. So this is a key building block in algorithm configuration, is comparing two configurations. You have an incumbent. Is this new configuration better than that incumbent, or is it not? We could just evaluate it on all the instances that we have, on all the folds. But in practice, well, that's not what we want to do, because that's expensive. And what we use is an approximate racing approach. We only do a few runs for very poor configurations and many runs for good ones. And as we get confident enough that this challenger is better than the incumbent, then we update the incumbent. And we have this invariant that the number of evaluations for the incumbent grows over time. And then Well, we aggressively reject poor configurations in order to not waste too much time with the poor configuration. And very often, actually, this happens after a single run. But if the algorithm decides to, then it can get a configuration later if we mistakenly rejected it. But we don't do, for example, a hypothesis test because that would just be slower than doing a single run. It would give us lower type 2 error, of course. So here's a very simple algorithm that's very much like James's random search for algorithm configuration. Call it ROAR. We select the configuration uniformly at random and then compare it to the current incumbent using this aggressive racing approach. So this is random online aggressive racing, ROAR. And that actually does very well. In many instances, it actually does better than my previous work on local search and whatnot. My intuition is that those are the cases where we actually do have low effective dimensionality, the type of problems that James talked about yesterday. And then we can extend this to use models on top of it. So this is a sequential model-based algorithm configuration where we construct a model to predict the algorithm performance, very much like the GP before, and use that model in order to select promising configurations instead of random search, and compare each of these configurations to the incumbent, just like in ROAR. The models, I looked at approximate Gaussian processes, I looked at random forests just tended to do a lot better because of random forests, because the GPs with high dimensions, with discrete input data and so on, with hundreds of thousands of data points, different approximations, made it all pretty complicated and still relatively slow. And also the predictions were just better with the random forest. So that's why I'm kind of stuck with the random forest for the last couple of years. Random forests, not sure who knows exactly what they are. They're forests of regression tree. Building a regression tree is pretty simple. Here's an example. So you have this data. You have parameters and you have features of your problem instance, the context, and runtime. So this is your data. And you build a regression tree, well, by just splitting on one column at a time. So for example, we split this data here according to parameter 3. The red data points go left, the other ones go right. At each point, you only store that split criterion. Yeah? So the data consists of parameter configuration. So we ran a certain parameter configuration on a certain instance, and out came a runtime. So we have parameter settings, so parameters that describe the configuration, but then we have features that describe the instance. And so this is a context. Yeah, and the random forest doesn't care which one is which. That's why I just put them all in there. This is describing the problem instance that was. Sorry, I think there's some confusion. The features?
Yeah.
We don't want to optimize the features. The features are just given to us. There's a distribution of problem instances, and that's what we want to optimize over. Yeah, so it's not a matter of what the best features are for that problem instance, but it's which parameter setting is best for that instance, for solving instances with those features. Yeah, exactly. So we have a kitchen sink approach here. We have 130 features describing a SAT instance. Anything domain experts can come up with that we can compute in low polynomial time. Throw it all in, let the random forest decide what's important, and what's important depends on the domain, very much so.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sure this is actually... Yeah, however, this is a... Yeah, I mean, so for the theoretical analysis, for sure, it's all Lipschitz. For actual functions, you know, we're splitting on this in a tree. It's a tree-based decomposition. So you can have discrete change points where things just are, where the function looks completely different here than here. And yeah, so a single regression tree actually maps very closely to Remy's work there. If you wanted to analyze this theoretically, you would pick one regression tree and would carry out a very similar analysis as Remy does. In practice, you know, the random forest just give us much better predictions of the data. That's why we use a random forest, but we haven't analyzed it theoretically. And if you wanted to, then yeah, probably you'd go to a single tree. But yeah, I'm interested in theoretical analysis, so we may as well talk there. Well, it's not that everything is kind of goodish, but it's that, you know, there's some parameters that really matter. I'm not sure if you were at James's talk yesterday. Okay, so he had some insights into why random search actually works well if there's only few dimensions that really matter, and you need to, well, your optimizer could either try to find the good, the important dimension, or actually random search doesn't need to know which ones are the important ones. But so that is something that we see empirically, that there are actually only few dimensions that are important. And that's what these methods exploit, because. And empirically, based on these models, actually, it does fall out that in a lot of applications where we would have thought, where the domain experts like, oh, no, this is all important, actually, like, 2 or 3 parameters carry, like, 95% of the variance. So quite often, the intuition of the domain expert in these high-dimensional problems is actually somewhat misleading. And I've been there myself. It just didn't match my intuition. Yeah, so let me quickly go through the regression tree, and the random forest will alleviate it a little bit. So this is a greedy split. A parameter 3 carries the most information, so you split parameter 3. You only store that you split on that parameter. Then you split further, say, now on the feature. Doesn't matter what you split on. In each node, you only store the mean of the runtimes. So you store the mean of the guys left in the leaf. Do the same thing here. And then we have a tree. In order to predict a new data point, say this one here, we just pump it down the tree. So we say parameter 3, is that red? Oh, yes, it's red. Then feature 2, is it smaller than 3.5? No. So we go here, we predict this. So very simple, but very quick. And then random forests are sets of regression trees. Regression trees, as you said, they're greedy. They're, you know, they're very low bias, but they're high variance because they're so greedy. So to alleviate that a little bit, you subsample the data many times, as in bagging, and for each subsample, fit a randomized regression tree. And you get a higher bias but lower variance estimator that performs better in practice. And the complexity for fitting that is actually not so large. It's the number of trees times number of data points log squared number of data points. So the randomness is in the selection of which parameters do you split on. So what Leo Bryman did originally and what I do too is pick a random subset of the parameters or of the input dimensions at each split node and only consider one of those. So that's a randomness. But you could envision different randomizations. It would be nice to have. We should get the reference for sure. So anyways, how do you predict with this? You just predict with each of the trees. So you just pump your new value down each tree, and then you actually get some measure of uncertainty. If all your different trees predict the same thing, then you're pretty certain that that's actually a pretty confident prediction. If they predict wildly different, then you're uncertain. It's kind of a cheap way of getting uncertainty. It's not as pleasing as a Gaussian process setting, but it's fast and it works. And prediction is very fast, it's T log N.
But you do require a lot of data to compute that. Because it's a frequency set.
Yeah, sure, it doesn't have priors, so you need some more data. Sure.
You don't keep your variance between the
Yes, we also do that. Let's get over that. So here's a visualization of how the data actually looks like. I find this gives good intuition. So this is based on a million data points of running this SAT algorithm on a million different SAT instances. So you have SAT instances and configurations, random configurations of that SAT algorithm. And white here means it was a slow algorithm run. It timed out after 300 seconds. This is a log scale. Black means it was a fast algorithm run solved in milliseconds. So you have these easy instances that are solved by everyone really quickly. Hard instances that are solved by no one. You have configurations that solve more instances and those that solve less instances. And that makes the difference between an awesome algorithm and a very poor algorithm. And this is what we want to capture. And random forests actually do capture this quite nicely. So again, you have this space of configuration, space of instances. This is an approximation of your performance metric. This is the prediction based on different instances that we trained on and different configurations. So you get generalization across to new instances and to new configurations. If you don't see a difference, that's because it actually predicts pretty well. A GP predicts fairly poorly, and we played quite a bit with that, and we just didn't get it to work. This is an approximate GP, yeah. But we tried like five different approximations, and none of them worked. Yeah, and I tried and gave up. I'm sure, you know, a GP researcher who does that for life, if they put a lot of time into it, will get it to work, and I'm looking forward to that. Because I'd like to use proper variance estimates. So this is kind of a nice domain. We're not always that good, so there's a domain with the worst predictions, but even here we can pick up which are the easy instances and kind of some weak signal, which are the good configurations, which are the bad ones. And it suffices to actually do algorithm configuration. In the end of the day, as I said, we were interested in this expected performance across instances from a distribution of instances. So we can predict that by just, you know, summing across the instances. So we just take the average across all the instances here. That gives us the performance of that configuration on average. We put a discrete kernel, a weighted Hamming distance kernel. Pretty straightforward. Didn't help. So so we can get these predictions out of the model, and then we can put that together in the sequential model-based algorithm configuration. So we do some initial runs, learn the model, use the model in order to actually select a set of promising configurations. Because this takes quite a while, we want to not only select one point and then think 5 minutes and then run another second and think 5 minutes and run a second. We compare each of these configurations to the incumbent and repeat until our time budget is exhausted. I skimmed over a few details here. The selecting a set, we also actually put some random configurations in there to recover some of the nice characteristics of random search. If the model just fails for some reason, we can put different acquisition functions in here to get that set and just put them all in. Exactly, yeah. So it, yeah, exactly. And our theory that, well, it converges to the optimal configuration, but we don't have convergence rates. And in a distributed setting, well, it's trivial. It can take the set here and distribute it across a cluster, and also, well, do more runs on the good configurations. You can distribute that across a cluster, too. All right. One trick, I said we can, when we minimize runtime, if we know that the incumbent, say, takes 20 seconds and we compare a new configuration to the incumbent, we don't need to run it longer than 20 seconds in order to know that it's worse. So we can actually cut off this run early and get a censored data point. We only obtain a lower bound on the runtime of that algorithm. And we can put that into the random forest. So here's a picture where we have the true function, and here these blue dots are actual function evaluations, and the x's are lower bounds, runs that were terminated early. And we can still fit a random forest and do expected improvement. We pick this point here, we actually get this point here, and we pick this point, and we only give it a runtime that's a little bit higher than the incumbent we have. Actually, it's lower than the function value, so it's a censored data point. We fit the model overestimates a little bit because all the model knows that it's higher than this point. But it's a much faster function evaluation than it might have been. In particular, with these runtime varying between milliseconds and days, it's really important to do the censoring. The random forest, actually, we have an EM-type algorithm here that just iterated imputation. But in the end, it actually predicts the actual runtime. All right, but that's a speed-up trick. And you can do that whenever your cost function of taking a function sample is exactly the objective function that you're optimizing, or a strictly monotonic function thereof. For example, if you were to minimize energy consumption of a data structure or something within a certain budget of energy that you can use for the experiment, you could do the same thing. All right, so let me talk about some experiments and then move on. These experiments are mostly based actually on this previous work on local search for, because we had it earlier and we put it on the web in 2007, so people started using it for all kinds of different problems. I'll give the one slide summary of some of these applications that I did for optimizing a SAT algorithm and a mixed integer programming algorithm with 76 parameters, 26 parameters, large speedups. And so all these applications here, this was actually fully published at the application conference. It's a black box tool. It applies kind of to any algorithm configuration problem. Of course, it has certain assumptions, but these assumptions seem to hold fairly broadly. So here's this case study. So we optimized this SAT algorithm with 26 parameters, 10 to the 17 configurations. We ran ParamLS for 2 days, 10 machines each, for two different data sets, one from software verification, one from hardware verification, and got, well, one configuration for each data set, compared that to the default on a test set of previously unseen instances, and here's the result. So here's the original default and the optimized setting, the log-log scale. Below here, we get a speed up. Dot is a problem instance, a SAT instance. So for easy instances here, we actually see a little bit of a slowdown. The optimized configuration takes longer than the original default. But for the hard instances, we get a speed up. And that's just because in manual algorithm development, you tend to not be very patient. You look at instances that maybe take a couple of seconds, minutes. You're not going to look at those instances that time out after a day. And this here is actually timing out after a day. And the good configuration, none of the instances would take longer than 10 seconds. So the automated tool, in some sense, has the patience to look at the hard instances too once in a while and actually make improvements there. And the objective that they wanted to achieve was mean performance. Mean is dominated by the hard instances, so you actually should pay attention to the hard instances. Yeah, so, I mean, a distribution, it's nice to have an instance generator, and we do have that in many distributions. Here, we actually only have 600 instances, so we trained on 300, and this is data on the remaining 300 test instances that we never looked at before. We could, in principle, overfit like crazy, but, well, in practice, it actually doesn't happen, right? So these 600 instances are pretty, like, they're from this doing a static analysis on, like, 10 different programs, and all of these SAT instances have certain structures that help certain parameter settings do well on these structures. But the more in this case, yes, but we also did other cases where we didn't do that and it still worked. Yeah. And that still worked. But there is no guarantee, right, as in machine learning. If your test distribution comes from a different setting than your trained data, all bets are off, in a sense. So the story there is once we find something that actually takes relatively time for these hard instances, then we cut it off. So if we have this incumbent here, if we now ran a new configuration, we would cut it off after 10 seconds for this instance because it's already worked. Yeah. Oh yeah, it's hard instances. And you know, humans don't have the bandwidth to say, after 10 seconds, I already can cut this off. I can try the next. It's just a high-dimensional optimization problem. Humans are not good at that. So we got a 500-fold speed-up, and this actually resulted in winning the SMT competition in 2007. Similar results for the hardware verification setup, not quite as this. Same setup of harder instances, we get more speed-ups. Mixed integer programming, in a nutshell, is the industry standard for dealing with problems that have continuous variables and integer variables. So you exploit the power of linear programming in terms of computational efficiency, but the expressive power of having integer constraints and, for example, binary constraints. You can't hire 2.5 people. You hire 2 people or 3 people. And that actually makes mixed integer programming NP-hard. So there is the industry best existing solver for this, IBM iLog Cplex, being the leading solver for, I think, by now pretty much 20 years. Very widely used. Nevertheless, it has a ton of parameters. And the manual actually encourages playing with those parameters in order to get better performance, which is a high-dimensional optimization problem in itself. We used parametric box exactly the same way and got very similar speedup. Cplex does include a tuning tool. We compared to that too and perform better. So we actually have a grant with Cplex right now to integrate that into Cplex. Right. I don't have that graph, but in most cases, it did significantly better. There were some where there was actually no significant difference. Actually, it was this slide here where I'm actually comparing SMAC against this ParmLS. These case studies were just ParmLS. So SMAC does better than ParmLS, but only a little bit. You know, only like up to 2-fold speed ups. Because ParmLS already got the 500-fold speed up. ROAR, in some cases, it was worse than ParmLS. In some cases, it was better for optimizing Cplex. It was always worse. So Cplex has this high-dimensional space, and you actually need to kind of find your gradients in that space. So there you need something smarter. But as James showed yesterday, there are some cases where you don't need the fancy stuff. All right. Have some. You optimize mean, right? So you take the mean across all these state points, the default. So that's the mean across this and the mean across this. And that's what you optimize. So based on a single run of an easy instance, it looks like the optimal configuration is worse than the default. If you wanted to optimize speed up over the default, which is actually something that the Cplex guys want to optimize, then you just change your objective. And you can do that too, and then the picture looks a lot more like you're here. You just get a uniform speed up, but you don't get quite as large speed up for the hard instance. Okay. So you can distribute this on a cluster. So we had we got almost perfect speed ups with up to 16 parallel workers. With 64, it kind of went to a 50-fold speed up. It doesn't parallelize perfectly because you do have the sequential loop, and every iteration can exploit all the data from the last iteration. So it doesn't parallelize perfectly, but very nicely in practice, reducing the time for optimizing a lot. That is correct. Something that we're working on. There's other methods for doing that that are also explored in our group. So I didn't use that particular method for it, but you could. And I do actually want to do Bayesian optimization for that. Good. So this kind of concludes the part on algorithm configuration and sequential model-based optimization. Quick plug on using the same types of models for doing some other reasoning. So this is the work that's referred to in the beginning. This is led by Leyton in our lab. And it's exactly the setting. We observe an instance. We compute the features of the instance. We use an algorithm selector in order to pick between an existing set of algorithms. In this case, just the SAT algorithms from the previous competition that did really well. And on a per instance basis, say this algorithm should be used. And that was enough to actually win the SAT competition 3 times in a row. In 2011, we didn't submit in order to not discourage development of new algorithms. But then people were like, oh, what happened to Zatzilla? It's dead. And it's not good anymore. So we submitted it. They're changing the rules now so that they get medals and we also get medals. So that's good. And really, the SAT community over the last 10 years has really started to embrace this approach. They all know that, well, there is an Norm free lunch theorem. There isn't a single optimizer that's best across the board. So you need to do some sort of reasoning in order to pick the best thing for everything. All right, so that's one application of these models. Another application is to say how important is each variable. So in the SAT algorithm, actually we had results using functional ANOVA, that 93% of the variance is due to only the single parameter. And we can also look at how good is each value of that parameter. So these are kind of some standard heuristics, and these are other heuristics that were implemented. So it looks like, oh, these always work better. But it's data set dependent. So for this bounded model checking case, that's what I just showed. This is for software verification, and there is all of a sudden there's this variable selection heuristic that does really well. And the domain expert had no idea of this. I asked him, oh, would this be better or that? And he's like, oh, I don't know. This is just two things I implemented. I have no idea. And this actually was the worst, and that is the best. They say, use the variables in the order created or the reverse order created. And like, oh, I don't know. So it's you can run this analysis once you have a model. You can do this in a second. Really tell the algorithm designer some useful information that can help him guide algorithm development by just doing all these statistics over high-dimensional runtime data. All right, with that, let me move on to the next point. A rather different method for scaling Bayesian optimization to high dimensions. So this is joint work with Zio Wang, who led this at UBC, Dave Matheson, Masru Azoghi, and Nando, submitted to this year's NIPS. So here the intuition is that sometimes, very much as in what we just talked about now and what James talked about, sometimes not all input dimensions are important. So we'll have some high-dimensional function d, and we'll assume that the true function lives in a low-dimensional intrinsic embedded function. So here's an example. So we know that only one out of two dimensions is important, and say the important dimensions are axis aligned. We can be in one of two cases. Either this parameter is unimportant, and this is important, and so this is a box that we're optimizing the function over, and the optimum is somewhere in this box. So either this parameter is unimportant, and that's important, or this is important, and that's unimportant. If this here is unimportant, and this is a global optimum, well, then all of this is a global optimum. And if this one is unimportant, then all of this is a global optimum. So we can put an embedding in this space, a one-dimensional embedding, that actually intersects the region of optimal configurations in either case. So we don't know which one is important, but our embedding will contain optimum in this case here, in this simple case. So we can do a Bayesian optimization in this embedding here and have a chance of finding the optimum because it is contained in this one-dimensional subspace. The same idea kind of generalizes to random embeddings in high-dimensional spaces. So here's a random embedding in this two-dimensional space. Again, we want to find the minimum in this two-dimensional case. We have a random embedding now that's not perfect. So once we go past here, we actually need, in order to evaluate this point here, we need to go back into the box and then evaluate this point. So we have this one-dimensional space, and we have a randomly sampled matrix, a matrix with random entries sampled from a Gaussian, a normal Gaussian. And we have this high-dimensional space X, R to the D. X is an element of that. A low-dimensional space where Y lives in, and this is a relation between the two. And we can prove that if the effective dimensionality of this function is at most lower D, then with probability 1, there is a, for any point in this high-dimensional space here, there is a y in this lower-dimensional space here that has the same function value. Now, we can use this for Bayesian optimization. So there's a standard Bayesian optimization and Bayesian optimization with a random embedding. And the random embedding only differs by, well, first step is you initialize a random matrix, and then where this guy here chooses an element of a high-dimensional space, Here you choose an element of your low dimensional space by maximizing your utility function over that low dimensional space. And then the data is your low dimensional data point. And in order to evaluate that data point, you need to go back into the high dimensional space. So it's a projection back up into the high dimensional space. And this actually works. It's a trivial algorithm. And we'll have three experiments to show that this actually works in practice. So the first one is optimization in a million-dimensional space, where we have a three-dimensional function that's embedded in a million-dimensional space with 999,000 truly unimportant dimensions added to it. And what we're plotting here is a gap metric that when it's 1, you have actually found the optimum. And we're comparing just simple Bayesian optimization here to different variants of this random embedding Bayesian optimization. And they're actually, they're more or less indistinguishable. They all achieve the optimum pretty quickly, whereas a Bayesian optimization in just in a 20-dimensional space, we couldn't run the original Bayesian optimization in a million-dimensional space, of course. But even in a 20-dimensional space, it just it stagnates. It can't move towards the optimum anymore. With the random matrix. Yeah. Well, it's a capital D times lower D. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this case here didn't quite cover that yet, and I don't actually have slides for that. I have the experiments for it, but so you basically, you say if you have a binary, along that axis, if you're between 0 and 0.5, you choose false. If you're above, you choose true. And there you go. So that's after your projection backup. And does that answer? And yeah, so, well, I'll show you the experiment for the discrete case. Again, we optimize Cplex here only on a one-dimensional instance. So this really only looks at the problem of searching the space, not so much at the problem of how many function evaluations should you do at each configuration. So it takes that completely out of the picture. Only one instance. We're optimizing solution quality. You can achieve in fixed time. So there's no censoring or anything of that complexity going on. But it can search the space effectively. We have random search and Bayesian optimization up here, both pretty bad. And then parmaless actually does better than them. But in this case, the random embedding with Bayesian optimization for this single instance actually does better than parmaless. So it is competitive. And it can actually do some search, and it gets some traction there, which is somewhat surprising to start that it actually works in the 76-dimensional space based on a low dimensional effective dimensionality of 3. We don't know the true effective dimensionality, and still just saying, well, let's try 3 effective dimensions, it already works. One thing I should have said for the million dimensional one, this also works for rotated functions. So you don't have to have axis aligned important dimensions. Well, no, the noise, we haven't done the experiment, then that's actually something that we'll have to do. Yeah, so the almost irrelevant, that's really something we want to look at next. And I'm looking forward to that. Because that's really what you have in practice. You have some that dominate and some that are still somewhat important. So, yeah. No, and it would have to take that into account, otherwise you can't do global optimization. Thank you. Right, third experiment here is kind of a more real-world application. Body part classification on the Kinect. You have 14 parameters that come mostly from the features. There's 4 parameters for random forests. And Bayesian optimization in the original space just stagnates, doesn't do anything, and Bayesian optimization in 3 dimensions actually does quite well. Interestingly enough here, random actually is really much better than the Bayesian optimization in the 14-dimensional case. It's just high dimensions is not good for Bayesian optimization with CPs. But with a low effective dimensionality, we actually do recover this nice property of field. All right. Moving on to another application of SMBO. Again, this one is quick. This is applying these methods to do automated model selection and hyperparameter optimization at the same time. AutoVECA, I guess the title is pretty suggestive. VECA, oh, no, never mind. I first have some related work on model selection and hyperparameter optimization. But in a nutshell, VECA has all these classifiers in there. There's subparameters. Which classifier do you want to use with which hyperparameter setting? That's a task we want to tackle. How do we do this? Well, we score a fully instantiated model using cross-validation. So you have some learning algorithm with some parameters that you apply to your training set and validate on a validation set. And you want to, very much like in James's setting, find the best parameter setting and actually the best algorithm too. Model selection, there's related work on that, where this capital lambda is relatively small. It's a small finite set of candidates. Goes back to Marin and Moore, Hufting races. And there's some related work by UBC. So let me quickly plug that. You can use standards for doing this. Say we want to optimize leaf on out cross-validation, so pulling an arm is just the same as evaluating one fold for a model. And there's results for all kinds of different approaches. The Hufting races are similar here. We want to minimize perform the simple regret with model evaluations. Hufting races do pretty poorly. There's a bunch of other methods, all of which do pretty well, including Thompson sampling, Bayes UCB, Bayes Q. BaseQ in particular looked pretty nice. And here's a plot of how your posterior of model performance changes over time. So you notice that the best predicted model, in this case an FVM, wiggles quite a bit. That means it gets this arm gets drawn quite a bit, whereas all these guys here, these are just the mean predictions. They don't change much at each time. You can only pull one arm here. Yeah. Well, in this case, every arm has fixed hyperparameters, and you would have to make an arm for every algorithm hyperparameter combination. Yeah, so this is uncorrelated arms. It's purely just model selection, solving exactly the problem that Hufting races solve, but using bandits and being faster. Exactly. Yeah, so you can combine this with these hyperparameter optimization methods that focus more on searching the space. These guys focus more on how many folds to do each. These guys focus more on how to search the space. And it's really a subroutine that will have to be used in efficient methods for hyperparameter optimization too. So that's why it's orthogonal. Oh, that's certainly true. No. But, that would be hilarious. Yeah. Also, but in the end of the day, the banded one, it doesn't exploit that correlation, right? And that's, you know, that's as bad as you can get, and still you can do pretty nice. Can get pretty nice results. I still like the adjective in papers. anyway, so this project was all about bringing model selection and hyperparameter optimization together using this TPE and SMAC, which can deal with conditional parameters. So all the hyperparameters of the model are just conditional on that model being chosen. And then we look at Mecca, which is just super widely used. 16,000 citations on Google Scholar. So there's all these people who know nothing about machine learning. They use Mecca out of the box. And it was one of 30 base classifiers, 14 meta methods, 3 ensembles. They're kind of getting lost in all these what's out there. So what we want is a true off-the-shelf solution, a green button, learn, and then go learn and give them a good classifier for their data. So that's the motivation here. The configuration space is, well, this top-level parameter is, are you an ensemble? Or are you a base classifier or not? If you're not a base classifier, are you a meta classifier or not? For each meta classifier actually has one base classifier as a child. Each ensemble can, in principle, have an unlimited number of base classifiers as a child. So there we had a limitation. We actually only looked at up to five conditional subclassifiers. We don't search the entire space, but it's big enough. Got 800 parameters in there. Many of them are conditional, of course, and some of them are repeated. The base classifiers are repeated in each of the 5 subclassifiers of the ensemble. And we optimize, well, either for cross-validation, or we can also look at repeated random subsampling, where we subsample part of the training data and use a disjoint part of the validation data as test. There we can then actually do more folds. Leaf one out cross validation is actually known to be fairly high variance. So there we can do bootstrapping or any kind of functions using these different folds. We use tenfold cross-validation on Hefting races, the baseline, and TPE, all tenfold cross-validation. For SMAC, we actually, tried that too, but then we also tried these 1,000-fold random subsampling validation. For SMAC, we could do that because we don't actually pay 1,000 times as much for it, because we can say each of the folds is an instance, so it just only evaluates 1 or 2 folds for most configurations, and only for the good configurations it evaluates many folds. And the results in a nutshell, both SMBO methods, TPO and SMAC, clearly perform best, and SMAC typically was somewhat faster than TPE, but I do attribute that really just to this ability of not looking at all the folds for every configuration. In the end of the day, I think it's really, they're both quite similar. And in terms of test performance, SMBO and SMAC and TPE still perform best, but the difference got a little bit smaller. There's some amount of overfitting. And we're currently really looking at what is the best validation method. Is it cross-validation? Is it bootstrap? There's many different ones out there. We kind of want to come up with a data-dependent one, a data-driven one that's best for that particular application. And that, I'm at the end. So I introduced Bayesian optimization. Then we looked at SMAC for algorithm configuration, random embeddings for scaling to high dimensions, and this application to AutoVECA. To conclude, SMBO is a very powerful global optimization method, and we can extend it to high dimensions, all kinds of different settings that are important in real-world applications, and can achieve state-of-the-art results. Importantly, this yields better results than manual tuning, and we get reproducible results for no human time.